Hello, everybody. This is E-commerce Scaling Strategies by Sales Genomics. And on this episode, we've got two really awesome guys, not one, by two, but two Nicks, Nick and Nick from Stacked SCM. Those guys have actually generated over 25 million in their own e-commerce stores, after which they've created something called an e-commerce syndicate that together sells around 100 million in D2C products. But also what those guys do is they have a free PL center that has shipped over 1 million packages up to date. So, hey guys, super cool to have you on the call. We're going to talk sourcing. We're going to talk supply chain for e-commerce and how all of those aspects of the supply chain can affect ROAS, profitability, and the scalability of a business.
Hey, Matt. Thanks for the awesome intro.
Cool, guys. Super excited about this because that's, you know, like me, especially being a marketer, this is not an area where I spend most of my time on, but it has such a big impact on the e-commerce business success. So tell me, guys, a bit more about how did you end up in this space and what does your company actually do?
So we started selling in e-commerce ourselves around 10 years ago. And over the years, we ran into countless supply chain issues. So once we got up to scaling 6 and 7 figure months, we started to run into consistent problems with fulfillment centers and with manufacturers overseas. Those issues led into increased chargebacks, refunds, ad accounts going down, pages going down. And we hit a point after we lost about $250,000 on one of our big sales where we said enough is enough. It's time to take over this vertical of the e-commerce business so that we never run into these issues again.
Got it. So what sort of issues did you experience? How did you actually end up losing this money, and what kind of problems are you currently, is your company helping the e-commerce stores with?
Yeah, so we ran a big sale. We did about $1.5 million over a 5-week time frame. And this put a lot of stress on our manufacturing partners. So they ended up seeing delays. Products weren't being shipped out of India and China for around 4 to 6 weeks. And then by the time it was getting into the fulfillment center at around 7 to 8 weeks in, this fulfillment center actually started to lose our inventory. And we ended up having to send one of our guys to find our inventory in their warehouse. This is one of the big three fulfillment providers in the space. Though this company had raised $100 million in venture capital, they still weren't able to service our supply chain the way that they had promised. That led to customer chargebacks, customer refunds, our page went down, and we lost ad accounts. So all in all, the project went from what should have been around $500,000 of profit to only around 200 to 250.
Oh, wow. That sounds like actually a common problem, especially of some businesses that started to scale really fast when COVID hit initially, right? And then, you know, the supply chains, the sales handled it, but the supply chain didn't at all.
Definitely.
So now, from what I understand, you guys are helping businesses solve those sort of fulfillment problems and supply chain problems. So can you talk more about a bit about that? What do you guys actually do?
Yeah, so I'll take that one. We do e-commerce supply chain. So a lot of times the first thing that people ask, okay, like what does that entail? So we like to kind of break it down into three separate verticals. So the first vertical is order fulfillment. It's your traditional fulfillment center. So it's pick, pack, order fulfillment. And in that vertical, we've done over 1 million packages in the past year alone. So that's our biggest and that's our staple. And then we have two other verticals that we are working in that are growing at a great rate. The second one is print on demand. So we have an in-house direct to garment machines and we have screen printing machines. So we do everything from canvases to backpacks to t-shirts. You kind of name it, we can pretty much print on it. So last month, this past month, we've done 50,000 t-shirts. We've been doing a lot of canvases, more and more, stuff like that. So that's a growing part of our business as well. And then the third leg of this is our sourcing division. So we work with 5 different countries that all have different needs. So what we kind of tell people is different products have different countries. So different countries are good at certain things. So India is really good with textiles and fabrics and things like that. So everyone always kind of wants to go right to China, but what we end up finding is India has really cheap prices too for certain products. We use other countries for other products as well. So we don't just use China, and we have sourcing agents on the ground in these countries. And then we also have manufacturers. So if there's like a product, let's just say it's on Alibaba, then we would be able to go to a sourcing agent and then he kind of would do the speaking to the Chinese people that have these products. And there's kind of like the American price and then the Chinese price. So when they're negotiating it, we can get cheaper prices every time than Alibaba.
Got it. Yeah, that sounds like you guys basically went from, you know, like selling the products to owning the whole supply chain. What other benefits does, you know, owning the whole supply chain have?
A lot of our sellers are able to take advantage of significant cost savings. So whether that's getting off of a Printify or a Printful type of POD platform, when they're ordering the tees through us, they're going to save around 30 to 40% on them. When it comes to sourcing, if they're going directly to a sourcing agent themselves or even to a manufacturer, when they're negotiating, they're only going to be doing so on their company's total volume. When we go to our manufacturing partners in other countries, we're doing it on behalf of our entire portfolio. So it improves our leverage quite a bit when it comes to negotiating on these price points. So on sourcing, we're usually saving around 20 to 40% there as well. And then with fulfillment, we've secured some of the best rates in the industry through UPS. So typically right off the bat on just the pick, pack, order fulfillment, we're saving around 10 to 20% for our clients there as well.
Yeah, so obviously the margin improvements help stay profitable, even if, let's say, you've been impacted by the latest iOS changes. I think that's, you know, like really nailing all aspects of the business, like this, you know, potential crisis for some advertisers might actually mean that only the fittest sellers, the fittest on every level, are going to stay on the market. So, you know, optimizing the whole chain of the business is really, really crucial. Speaking about the crises and the COVID issues, how has COVID impacted the e-commerce supply chain from your perspective?
Seeing that every single day right now, still. So what ended up happening is obviously the pandemic slowed everything down, and then they got it back to a point where things were starting to get back to normal with shipments from Asia and India and stuff like that. But then as all these countries, the United States, everyone started opening back up, it then restrained the supply chain again. So as of right now, an already strained out supply chain is just getting restrung. So it's going through a lot more growing pains again. And we're finding a lot of the ports in China at this moment are delayed and backed up and things of that sort.
Got it. And
Yeah, like India, for example, right now, parts of India just went back into a lockdown too. So depending on what part of that country you're sourcing product from, you could be seeing manufacturing delays from there as well. It really is one of the best times ever to source domestically, wherever that might be for you as a seller. But we're seeing the best results coming from clients that are able to bridge past some of these foreign imports that have some of these problems and delays going on to sourcing it locally.
That sounds like a local fulfillment might be the solution. But actually, like, is it always a trade-off between, let's say, having good prices and sourcing domestically, especially in the US? Like, are you able to get, you know, like good prices as well within the local sourcing?
So when it comes to things like garments, yes. So that's not affecting print on demand at all. Now take it, these garments are coming from other countries, but there are huge distributors in the United States that hold massive inventory of them. So we're still able to take advantage of the cheap international prices, but get them from a large US distributor so that our clients, when it comes to something like print on demand, are able to get the consistency they need with delivery times and take advantage of prices that you would see in foreign markets. And then depending on the product type, you can find certain products that would be cost effective in the US. For example, bulky items, because shipping prices driven up by COVID are so high and inflated right now, if you were selling something like dinner tables, for example, something very bulky and very heavy, it would make much more sense to source that from the United States or Canada.
Got it. And so speaking back about, because I know that probably a lot of our viewers, their default method and source of their products is China. But let's talk more about what does fulfillment look like outside of China? What sort of countries are, we mentioned briefly India, what other countries are good for sourcing? What types of products?
Yeah, so we source a lot from Thailand and Indonesia as well. And then Pakistan, we began to work with them also, as well as the United States and Canada. And each one of these countries does have its own specialty, as Nick was saying before. For example, Pakistan specializes in leather. whereas Thailand and India are going to have advantages with textiles.
What about certain, let's say, home decor stuff? Is it something that you mostly want to get in the US, as you mentioned, because the products are usually bulky, or is there also some other channels for this?
Yeah, so if it's something like the canvases or frames behind you, that would make sense to source in the US for that exact reason. They're bulky. And what ends up happening is there are certain distributors that they'll order in $1 million of canvas at a time and then have it stretched, placed on the wood frame, and then house it at their warehouses across the country. When we have a client that wants to sell POD canvases, for example, we can then go to that distributor and say, hey, we need 1,000 of these by the end of the week. That's no problem. So the shipping times are fast and we're taking advantage of someone that bulk imports this stuff by shipping crate, you know, in millions at a time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, understood. So let's talk a bit. Let's say I'm an e-commerce owner and I'm looking to switch from China fulfillment to some sort of, or let's say I'm completely new in this business and I'm looking to set up my supply chain. What are the do's and don'ts of e-commerce supply chain?
Yeah, so kind of what we see is that mostly people will start off drop shipping off AliExpress. Is one of the biggest verticals that we'll find, or we'll find that people are doing their own fulfillment. So these are what like kind of bogs people down and goes right into their margins. So if they're doing their own fulfillment, then they're a lot of their time at their house, they're spending pick, pack, order, fulfillment, sending it out, working on the whole supply chain. So what we end up seeing is that most like companies that are offering services are offering stuff what we would consider on the front end. So advertising, courses, how to scale up your business. No one's really talking about the back end here, which is supply chain, sourcing your products, getting fulfillment, getting the right price there to set up your ads and make sure that you don't have a bad page score or anything like that. But yeah, the number one thing that we see is people drop shipping off AliExpress, and that can take up to 8 to 10 weeks to never to get to your customer. And then that just people's ad accounts go down. They're like, oh, I don't know what I'm doing. My ad account went down. So we kind of will see that happening a lot as well, where people just aren't worried about the back end because everyone's just so concerned about the front end, and rightfully so, because that's the big generator.
I see. So you're saying, you know, like once you kind of exceed the volume where you can ship the products yourself, then it's time to set up some sort of next level fulfillment. So what is this next level fulfillment in this case? What are the biggest mistakes to avoid when setting this up or when choosing a fulfillment partner?
Yeah, so how we kind of differentiate ourselves in that vertical of fulfillment is every other fulfillment center charges A, like warehousing fees that we don't charge, but B, the big thing is additional pick fees. So every single fulfillment center will have pick fees. So the first one will be a pick fee, and then each additional item in your cart is an additional pick fee, anywhere from 25 to 50 cents, depending on the fulfillment center. And that makes it really hard to project out costs, and it just eats into your bottom line. So we actually got rid of them here. So we just do one pick fee and postage rate, and that's it. So it's really easy for our partners to project their revenue and things of that sort.
Yeah, and it really is a nightmare to predict it with those all this model. Yeah, and also you mentioned something about storage fees, right? That those companies also...
Yeah, so that's another big thing. Your products come right in. Even if your products are going right out, they're going to be charging you storage fees. So that's just another area where it's just hard to project, and it kind of feels like someone's getting over on you when at the end of every month you get hit with a bill for products that you're putting there and they're charging you for. So we, coming from e-commerce, kind of saw some of these things as hindering profit reports, but just hindering profit, like your actual profit. So it was like, hey, it's hard to project profit reports, and then B, it's hard to make profit with all of these fees. So we just kind of pulled it out from both of that so that no one has to deal with those type of problems. And it allows everyone to just save a bunch. You know, we keep talking about saving a lot to their bottom line.
Awesome. And also one thing I wanted to really ask you is, how is the Amazon standard of the, you know, same day shipping actually affecting e-commerce when, you know, the most of the standard, let's call it, e-commerce businesses cannot really compete with that?
Amazon has definitely moved the goalpost on, you know, what people expect and customer expectations. So how we've seen that affecting Facebook is that they introduced the Facebook page score, and they've continued to enforce that more and more, where what used to be acceptable on Facebook ads a few years ago, you can no longer get away with. So the extremely long shipping times, poor product quality, things like that, Facebook setting it up to protect their consumers, their users. So the sellers that can adapt and start to hit faster shipping times with higher product quality, those are the ones that are going to survive. And it's really difficult to do that when you're drop shipping directly out of China, they're shipping via the Chinese post, and you know, 5 to 10% of your packages may never reach their end destination.
Yeah, that makes sense. And you know, it doesn't seem like it's getting any better. And there's speculations whether Amazon is going to dominate even, you know, the smaller countries in Europe and other continents. But I think that, you know, it definitely sets a precedent. But actually, so we've talked a lot about fulfillment and supply chain. Is there anything else that you think, you know, is among the top things that all the Shopify sellers should really consider when it comes to supply chain?
Yeah, so one thing a lot of people don't realize, because we talk about cost savings, and to them that might mean, oh, I'm making $5,000 a month. I don't want to go through and do all of this to make $6,000 a month. But that's not really how it works, because when you start cutting 20 to 30% off of your product costs and then 10 to 20% off of your fulfillment costs, it's going to enable you to start undercutting markets. And that's not the difference then of $1,000 here and there. That's the difference of a sale that might do $5,000 of profit at a very low margin, or a sale that can go all the way to $1 million to $2 million at a 10 to 20% margin. So it really enables people to start dominating in their markets rather than just surviving.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so actually let's talk about this, because we talked about supply chain a lot, right? But you guys are actually very successful e-commerce owners as well. So do you want to tell us a bit about what your e-commerce scaling strategies are, and how are you navigating the current times? Are you seeing any drops related to iOS, or are is it business as usual?
Yeah, so I mean, a lot of people are seeing changes in iOS, and us personally, we are as well. Like, Facebook's not picking up as many purchases as they used to, so it's kind of hard to say, hey, this return on ad spend, the ROAS on this one is a 2, but maybe it could be higher because it became missing some purchases. So that's definitely been affecting things like our rules and our bumping schedules. But when I'm just looking at the off Facebook ROAS, things are staying pretty similar so far. So that's a really good sign for us. And one of our main strategies that we do is we'll run CBOs with ad set controls. I mean, CBOs with cost cap controls. And basically we'll do 3 times our cost per purchase. So if I have a $20 cost per purchase, I would be setting my bid cap up at $60. And if I'm trying to scale, let's just say like a 3K budget or like a 5K budget, I would want to have like 40 different ad sets in there. Now, some of them can be the same inside of there, but 40 differential. And if I'm trying to do smaller amounts, we would say, let's just have 20 ad sets in that type of campaign if I was trying to run it at like a 1K budget.
Got it. That was very specific, actually. Thanks for sharing that. But also, you guys, what I know that you're doing that's very interesting and very different from most of our audience probably is you guys are not actually thinking about your, or at least from what Nick told me, right? You have brands. You guys don't have brands per se, but you're actually running sales, right? And a lot of very interesting funnels that many people don't know about. Can you talk a bit about that?
So I always tell people our specialty is undercutting markets. So from a holistic standpoint, that's how we've been able to win. We call it winning through your supply chain. So over the years, we would find hot products or new product verticals. For example, canvases, those blew up recently, but maybe no one's ventured into selling space-oriented canvases, just as an example. So you then populate out entire Shopify collections of space canvases, and you undercut the typical market price on a canvas. And then you start driving your traffic to that collection page so that it can encompass the entire space niche, quote unquote. With that in mind too, then you're driving traffic into a broader collection and a broad niche. Your price points are now under the market standard. So that's gonna start driving impulsive buying behavior. We also like to use time sensitivity. So we'll run things like closeout sales where once the end date has arrived, we get rid of the entire collection and move on to a new collection so people can't buy those products anymore. And combining all of those aspects at once creates extremely impulsive buying behavior. So that's allowed us to get our ad scaling quickly and then start driving out our competition in the space.
That's insane. I think that's something that a lot of brand advertisers could be learning from. I had a chat yesterday with a friend, and we were talking about how the biggest winners in general in any industry in business are really good at spotting trends. So how do you guys research your products or trends? How do you guys, you know, stay on top of what could be selling?
So when it comes to the product R&D, I like to take a few different approaches to it. I don't think it's just like one size fits all and you use this app to search this Etsy page. Those tools are helpful, but they are just tools, a part of a bigger plan here. So if I wanted to get into beauty products, I'm going to start looking into what's hot and what's selling online. I'm going to use those search tools. I'm going to look at what's winning on Amazon, what's the most popular and most pinned on Pinterest, what's selling the most on Etsy. For example, we live near one of the biggest malls in America. I'm then going to go into that store. I'm going to find what the designers are doing, what designer stores are selling. And then I'm also going to be looking at what celebrities are posting. I'm going to see what that hot thing is. And then I'm going to try to merge all of these things together. The stuff that's selling high volume on Amazon, the new hot trend with the celebrities, what's in the malls. And I'm going to try to find a collection then that is going to encompass all of these aspects. And then we're going to go use our supply chain to undercut the market and source similar products that are then going to be priced at 10 to 30% lower than market standard.
Amazing. And then what do you guys, so like, it sounds like there's, you know, there's not much branding to it. It's purely product and impulse behavior oriented. Do you guys have any, you know, moving from strategy to tactics, do you have any tips on creating a good, well-converting store for those sort of campaigns?
Yeah, we do. So we like to send, we basically like to think of Facebook as they're just, they have all their buyers lined up ahead of time. So if Facebook the day before already knows who's going to buy because they do, then we're saying that they're putting them in different brackets. So if the first bracket is like their best buyers that they know is going to go on a buying spree that day, well, they're going to send them to the highest, most high converting funnels. So that is what Facebook knows. So if you have a nice high converting funnel, they see a lot of traffic going there that day. That's when you can get to the next level in Facebook and actually get the $5 cost per purchase, $7 cost per purchase. And that's all about, hey, customer experience. So they see people getting to your landing page. Hey, the page load was really fast. They were able to click around, add to cart. Everything was really smooth. They're seeing a high add to cart rate. So if a lot of the statistics that they see on their end looking really good, then they're willing to send us some of their best buyers. And that's when we see like some of our highest ROAS days. So yeah, basically having a fast, high converting page goes an extreme long way. Setting your shipping times, having a good page score, these are the things Facebook's kind of looking at and encompassing and putting everything together and saying, hey, this is a great high converting landing page that we want to send our best customers to.
That's really cool. This is a great strategy. We're actually going to put this to the test as well. Or any other, what do you guys think also differentiates your approach to e-commerce from some of the other people? And what do you think is like the key to your strategy to enable you to make so many successful campaigns?
Yeah, I think that the key here is that what we're kind of saying and what the industry standard is, it's not that we're completely different, it's we're coming from a different angle. We're not saying that the front end isn't where a lot of the money's made, because if you're not doing good with Facebook ads or whatever platform you're using, then yeah, the supply chain doesn't matter. But it's, if you're doing that right and you have the good supply chain, then you can undercut the market. So if you're getting your product for way cheaper, then you could put your cost per, you know, your bid cap all the way as high. If it was something that's usually a $10 product and you're saying, hey, I'm willing to bid $60 for it, well, then Facebook's looking around and saying, who else is willing to bid $60 for that? No one. So no one's setting their bids that high. And basically you're just saying, give me all of it. I'll take the whole niche here. And if your product price is at such a low point that you can charge this really low price for the product, then no one can compete with you. So there's kind of like the bullying effect that happens on Facebook. So we're trying to bully out the competition. Everyone's trying to be in the same sphere there. So the second we can just get on a sphere above, Facebook knows that they're saying, hey, this is the only guy in this niche that's willing to bid this much and has his campaign set up at $10,000 budget.
Yeah, yeah. And Facebook knows how they should be making money for themselves as well, right? Where that money is going to be the best spent.
Yeah.
Awesome, guys. And so if someone wants to know more about this topic or want to work with you, and especially, you know, potentially considering joining your syndicate, or actually before we get to that, like, can you guys talk a bit more about this aspect of your business, the e-commerce syndicate?
Yeah, so one thing we did several years ago is we started to bring together a close-knit network of guys doing high-volume e-commerce. Along the way, too, we coached up many other people into doing high-volume e-commerce. And then a lot of us, we all stay closely in touch. And it's something that we then extend into our fulfillment and supply chain clients as well. So we have a tight-knit community, a lot of eight-figure sellers in the space. And it's not like it's a Facebook group or anything per se. This is a group of guys that likes to, you know, meet up at different locations, grab beers here and there, and just talk shop. So, or whether that be a phone call or whatnot, you know, we've created this community of people where other people coming in can really take advantage too, just by, you know, having conversations with people that have been there before. Or if someone's looking for a certain type of connection, there's a decent chance that we already know someone that's doing that.
Got it. And is there can someone who's a successful entrepreneur join this syndicate somehow, or is this completely private?
So when we originally started this, we've had multiple different houses that people can actually go in and live in an e-commerce type house. So we'll have 5, 10, we've had as much as 20 people live in an e-commerce syndicate house before. And basically, it's just everybody on the same page with the same mindset of, hey, I want to be an entrepreneur in e-commerce. And they're all like-minded individuals and they want to succeed. So they're all kind of work together. There'll be partnerships that form in these houses. There'll be collaboration that goes on. So with people that are trying to come in, we have a house right now where we have five different people in there doing e-commerce. And there is room in these type of environments for the right people.
Awesome. Yep.
And that's located in the Rocky Mountains out in Colorado, our current HQ.
Sounds like a dream. I hope I'm going to see you there one day when traveling is a little bit easier. Awesome. Yeah. So if someone wants to get in touch with you or potentially work with you guys, how do they find you?
They can come to our website and fill out our contact form. Or if they're in touch with you guys directly, you have our email addresses and you can just kind of form an email introduction for them.
Awesome. Cool. Yeah, I feel like I really learned a lot today, honestly, and actually I'm definitely going to ask you some more questions after this. So thank you guys so much for the time. Is there any last remarks you want to make or any tips on how to survive in e-commerce in 2021?
Yeah, win through your supply chain.
Awesome. Cool, guys. See you in the next episode, hopefully. Thanks a lot for your time. Cheers.
See you.
Thanks a lot for staying till the very end. This was E-commerce Scaling Strategies by Sales Genomics, brought to you by Matt from Sales Genomics. If you're interested in more tips and strategies on how to scale your e-commerce business, visit our Facebook group called E-commerce Scaling Strategies by Sales Genomics or follow us on social media.